Let's go, girls.
Hello? Is anyone there?
Oh, hello, and welcome to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are kicking off a week celebrating fictitious feminist icons. We are beginning with this mystery lady. Can you guess who it is? I'll give you a clue. She is the feminist icon that is cited by everyone from Ruth Bader Ginsburg to Sandra Day O'Connor, Barbara Walters to Barbara Streisand, Hillary Clinton to Oprah, as being one of the most formative figures in their youth that prompted them to have unconventional roles in their adulthood. Have you cracked the case? That's right, it's Nancy Drew, the original girl gumshoe. Before we had Veronica Mars or Velma or even Harriet the Spy, we had Nancy Drew. Today we're going to be raising a glass to her with a drink that I am calling Mystery at the Lilac Gin. The ingredients for this drink that you are going to need are gin, of course, some dry vermouth, some orange bitters, some lavender simple syrup, and our blue mystery ingredient. Well, you go wrangle all of that up. I am going to begin the story of Nancy Drew. Nancy Drew was first introduced in 1930. Her original Nancy Drew mystery series, before any of the spin-offs, has 175 volumes that have been translated into 25 languages and were written over the course of 73 years by one Carolyn Keene. Now, it seems impossible that one woman could take on the task of writing that many novels over the course of 7 decades. And in fact, it is impossible. Carolyn Keene is the pseudonym that was assigned by Nancy's creator, Edward Statmeyer. I know what you're thinking. Edward is a funny name for a lady. And it would be, but it's not. Nancy Drew was in fact dreamed up by a man, but to be fair, a truly remarkable man. Edward Statmeyer is one of the most prolific writers of all time. During his lifetime, he produced more than 1,300 titles, selling more than 500 million copies of his books. Among his series are The Bobbsey Twins, Tom Swift, and the very famous Hardy Boys. When it became clear that Edward had more ideas in his head than he was ever going to be able to put down on paper, he created the Statmeyer Syndicate. The Statmeyer Syndicate produced books in his series by hiring out ghostwriters to create manuscripts based on Edward's outlines. Writers were paid a flat rate of $150, which, to be fair, was about the equivalent of 3 months of full-time pay at a newspaper. However, they didn't receive any royalties, and during the Depression, this rate dropped to as low as $75 per title. Nancy Drew was more or less born out of complaints from girl readers of the Hardy Boys. These girls wanted their own heroine solving her own mysteries. Previous attempts by the Statmeyer Syndicate to create these kinds of books for their female audiences had failed pretty miserably, mainly because these books would focus on teenage girls who had adventures right up until the moment that their boyfriend proposed to them, they got engaged and settled down. Edward knew that this series had to be different. Edward didn't sketch out that much of Nancy's character. All he really set out was that she was 16 years old, she lived in the fictitious city of River Heights with her father Carson Drew, a lawyer, and her housekeeper Hannah. Her mother had died when she was a young girl. Most of the details of the spunky girl wonder were sketched in by another writer altogether, the very first Carolyn Keene. That is a mystery that I'll get back to, but first, the mystery of the Lilac Gin. All right, gumshoes, first things first. We gotta put some ice in our shaker, 4 or 5 cubes of ice. And then we're going to add our gin. Now you can see this gin is clear, not lilac. So nothing mysterious yet. The mystery of Nancy Drew's author, however, persists. So Edward gave her her name, but who gave Nancy her personality? Credit for that goes to Mildred Wirt Benson. Mildred was born in Ohio in 1905. She was the first person at the University of Iowa to earn a master's in journalism. And she was a news writer her whole life. Literally, from the time she graduated until just before she died when she was 96 years old, she was a newspaper woman. She was also an adventurer. She traveled all of South America, traversing jungles in her jeep, canoeing up rivers, and even flying planes. On top of all of that, she also wrote the first 30 or so Nancy Drew novels, which are some of the best-selling children's books of all time. Much of the Nancy Drew lore, as well as the structure, is established in these early books. If you've never read a Nancy Drew novel, it essentially goes something like this. First of all, Nancy sniffs out a mystery, which, by the way, having always wanted to be a famous girl detective, I have to tell you, that's the hardest part. Just finding a mystery. Nancy was so lucky. There were thieves and bad guys all over the place when she was looking for detective work. She would find them through some of her dad's clients or sometimes friends of friends who were in trouble. Often, you know, they were missing an item or something else mysterious had happened. So Nancy would jump into the case, often with the help of her two best girlfriends, Bess and George. Yes, George is a lady. Somewhere along the way, Nancy would find herself in some kind of peril. Often she would get knocked unconscious, then she would free herself from the danger, solve the case, and save the day. Nancy's ability to accomplish all of this as but a teenager was a result of the character that Mildred had created. Nancy was basically a teenage supergirl. She had already graduated high school at the time. She was 16 years old, so she didn't go to school. She was able to drive in her little blue roadster wherever she wanted, and she had plenty of money, so she truly was a teenager with complete autonomy. She was very popular, thus her friends often came to her with their mysteries, and she knew how to get herself out of trouble. If her car broke down, no big deal. Nancy knew how to change a tire. If there was a mystery that required advanced knowledge of historical catacombs, Nancy Drew was an expert. She spoke six languages. She traveled the world. She was a fine painter. She was athletic. She played tennis. She could row. She did horseback. She was a great dancer, a great bridge player. She was able to apply first aid. She could fire a gun. She was also beautiful and poised. Her Titian hair, which means strawberry blonde, and her striking figure are mentioned frequently in the early books. Not in a sexual way, though. She was just not a sexual being. She had Ned Nickerson, of course, her long-suffering boyfriend, but she was not thinking of necking or marriage. Nancy has broad appeal because she does it all. Women across the ideological spectrum can get on board with Nancy. She is a girl power feminist with a strong work ethic and squeaky clean Midwestern values. Like Mildred, Nancy Drew is confident, competent, and outspoken. Edward Statmeyer feared that this Nancy was too flip and was going to turn away readers. He was wrong. Nancy Drew was an instant hit when it was released in 1930. Now, this is before the days of bestseller lists, but we know that Macy's 6,000 copies sold out in a matter of days. It was just a mass phenomenon of what they called the 50 centers. Unfortunately, Edward didn't live to see this success. He died that spring suddenly of a heart attack, which meant that someone new was going to have to come in and outline and edit the whole Nancy Drew series, beginning with the fourth book, Mystery at the Lilac Inn, the namesake of our drink. Speaking of which, we gotta build this cocktail. We are going to add in a 1/2 ounce of dry vermouth, as well as a few dashes of orange bitters. Then we are going to add in a 1/2 ounce of our lavender syrup. Lavender, that's right. Mysterious, isn't it, that a drink called the Mystery of the Lilac Gin should have a 1/2 ounce of lavender in it? Why could that be? Well, in part, because of the name of the book. The book, The Mystery of the Lilac Inn, was the first in the series outlined by Harriet Adams, or more accurately, Harriet Statmeyer Adams. That's right, Harriet Adams was Edward Statmeyer's daughter. Born in 1892, young Harriet loved to climb trees. She was kind of a tomboy. She made friends with all the boys in her neighborhood. She wanted to break free of the woman's role of just being a proper housewife. She attended Wesley and desired to work outside the home, but her father said no. Not such a such a feminist when it came to his own family, though he was all right with letting Harriet edit novels from the comfort of their estate. After he died, Harriet took over the Statmeyer syndicate with her sister. From 1930 until her own passing in 1982, Harriet had a hand in virtually every Nancy Drew book that was published. For many years, Harriet claimed to be more or less the author of the entire series. Remember, Mildred was a ghostwriter. Her deal with the Statmeyer Syndicate was that she wasn't allowed to claim that she had written any of the Nancy Drew books. In fact, the truth about her work didn't come out until 1980, when she was called to testify in a case about publishing rights related to Nancy Drew. Many avid Nancy Drew fans consider Mildred's books the strongest, because they paint the most daring and unusual heroine, especially for the time they were written in. My favorite Nancy Drew book, and incidentally, Mildred's favorite, is book number 2, The Mystery of the Hidden Staircase. An example of Nancy Drew breaking stereotypes in this book happens when Nancy's father leaves for a business trip. Nancy is right in the middle of her case, and things are, you know, kind of seeming a little dangerous. Now, you would think that her father would say, "Nancy, darling, don't do anything crazy while I'm away. Be safe. Stay out of trouble." But no. He says, "Hey, Nancy, here's my gun. I know that you got this." That's right. He gives her his gun, completely playing against type. That's how much men, even in this society, trust Nancy Drew. And you know what? It's a good thing, too, because later in that very same novel, her father ends up bound and gagged in some creepy dude's basement, and Nancy has to go and save his ass as usual. Now, in the 1950s and 60s, most of these early books were rewritten. Some of them, like Mystery at the Lilac Inn, significantly written. Some of these rewrites were to make the books less offensive. You know, Nancy Drew's a lot of things, but she wasn't that woke. I mean, she understood her privilege enough to solve mysteries for those less fortunate than her and not accept any payment except a small token. You know, like an antique clock. But, you know, people weren't that enlightened in the 1930s, and she said some racist stuff and that had to go. Other changes to the books in the 1950s were to sanitize them, to change Nancy from the gutsy blonde of the 30s to a woman more acceptable in the traditionalism of the 1950s. Small things were changed, like where once it had said, "Nancy said," now it was written, "Nancy said sweetly," or "Nancy kindly asked." The covers shifted too. The 1950s art shifted from Nancy in her blue cloche and trench to more contemporary styles like sweater sets and penny loafers worn by bobby soxers. But they also changed the way Nancy positioned herself. The covers of the 1930s had Nancy in power positions, with her shoulders back, taking on the world. Later covers often depicted Nancy with her mouth agape, looking afraid, sometimes in peril. These were subtle changes, but the messaging was not subtle. The Nancy Drew stories of the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s that were written after Harriet Adams had passed away showed even more changes for the Nancy Drew character. Often she was shown on her covers wearing provocative ensembles, with sexy gentlemen taking up some cover space. Interestingly, Nancy Drew only aged 2 years between 1930 and the year 2003 when the series ended. She was originally 16 years old, but when the books were revised in the 50s, they shifted her age to be 18. However, in the new millennium, the girl got a lot of new skills. Now, she was emailing her clients and traded in her little blue roadster for a blue hybrid. Blue is something of a signature color for Nancy Drew, which is why we have our blue mystery ingredient. This ingredient is actually some sweet pea butterfly tea. If you do not have this very specific ingredient, it's fine. The flavor is very light. It's mostly for the color. So we're going to take our cocktail before adding our mystery ingredient. We are going to shake it and strain it into our martini glass. You'll see that the color of the drink is essentially clear. A little creamy, but mostly a clear whitish color. We're now going to add 1.5 ounces of our blue mystery liquid. And as we add it, gasp! Our drink becomes not blue, but purple. Some might even say lilac. Guys, it's a mystery. I can't figure it out. Honestly, I don't know. We'd need a sleuth like Nancy Drew to crack this case. Truthfully, I have no idea what the chemistry on this is. Nancy probably would. I am sure she is a world-class mixologist. The girl's skill set knows no bounds. Let's taste it.
It's good. It's strong.
Like Nancy Drew. I mean, it's basically a martini with a hint of lavender that, like, you know, you don't have to be a girl wonder sleuth to detect. But, you know, doesn't hurt if you are. Secretly, don't we all want to be a little bit more like Nancy Drew? I mean, she's the dutiful daughter who still has total autonomy, right? She's a little bit of kid, but fully grown up. She's a kind, courteous friend who's also capable of showing up the cops with her wit and expertise. She does it all, and she never feels overwhelmed. Cheers to the fantasy that is Nancy Drew. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back tomorrow. I'm going to have another lady, another libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls.